How's it going, everybody? I just want to apologize right off the bat for the sort of very obvious off-the-cuff impromptu look and feel of this particular video. I apologize for that, but I feel like the thing I'm about to talk about, I couldn't do any other way without doing it while it's fresh in my mind, and due to, like, kind of crazy circumstances, my normal filming location is kind of off-limits at this time of night, so this is unfortunately the best I could do on such short notice. And again, I you know, kind of too long and arduous to get into why, but, you know, suffice it to say, this is what I can do. So, another important thing to talk about before I even get started is that, because I watch a lot of shows every week, you know, basically the way my schedule works is after I finish a week of work is when I catch up on a lot of shows, be they anime or Western, when I go into a lot of Netflix binges over the weekend, and Crunchyroll, Funimation, whatever's come out for the week, I tend to watch on Friday, Saturday, and the early parts of Sunday. So, because of that, I tend not to comment on individual episodes of a show. I tend to save it for the end of the season where I talk about everything as a whole, if I can, or if I feel the need to. And so this is extra off the cuff. I'm not really sure how this is going to work. I don't know if I'll ever do anything like this again. But the reason why I don't talk about individual episodes of a show, because you really could, and a lot of people have made a very lucrative living doing so, commenting off of individual, having like reaction episodes of their own content, talking about things like Walking Dead, and especially last Sunday's episode of Walking Dead, there's a lot of people who are making videos talking about the big spoiler there, and I don't intend to. People do it for Game of Thrones all the time. The reason why I don't is because my feelings on the subject is that if I start ranting and raving about something that happens, like big plot stuff that happens in the middle of the show, like, I feel like, you know, it's more impactful to talk about everything together at the end, because then you're gonna, you know, when you talk about all that stuff together, you will, whatever you remember is the stuff you're gonna take away, and that's, you know, those are the good things to talk about. And, you know, I feel like doing a however long vlog-style video every week would be, you know, kind of arduous, and, you know, in my mind, for my particular skill set, I doubt many people would tune in. But this, what I'm about to talk about is something, I don't think anything, I mean, I hope nothing ever tops the what the fuck that I just watched. So, again, I'm about to apologize because I haven't had anything to drink and I foresee myself talking for quite a bit, so if you don't mind, I'm just gonna have a little booze. It's been a long day. Not your father's root beer, if you want to know. So, I watch quite a few simulcast anime because I am a horrible person. And I feel like that's a thing worth doing. I watched quite a bit in the spring. I watched even more in the summer. And here we are now for the fall season. And I think this is the most I've ever attempted to watch. Especially, I've gone, you know, 4 or 5 weeks, and I haven't dropped a whole lot either. And the show I'm about to talk about, I almost did drop, because at first I thought it was just going to be kind of bad. We're at a point in the fall season, you know, being that most stuff is 4 episodes or 5 episodes in, you can really tell what's going to be good and what's not so good. You know, that's an appropriate amount of time. Usually 3 episodes, you can tell what's going to be the good stuff and what's going to be the not-so-good stuff. So by episode 4, you can tell that Concrete Revolutio is going to be good. You can tell that Heavy Object is going to be good. You can tell that One Punch Man is amazing. And on the opposite end of the spectrum, you can tell that something like Anti-Magic Academy is not going to be very good, or something like The Asterisk War is not going to be very good. And the subject of today's little off-the-cuff, impromptu, stream-of-conscious vlog is Lance N Masques. Now, in order to fully appreciate the amount of what the fuck I'm about to describe, I have to go into spoilers. I'm going to spoil quite a bit of Lance N Masques, so if Lance N Masques was something on your list of things that you wanted to watch, maybe if you wanted to watch it when the season was over so you could watch everything when it was all out and you didn't have to wait a week, then by all means, do. If you're looking for a recommendation, I have to say no. It is not a show I recommend. It is not very good. The animation is nothing to write home about. The characters are fairly bland, especially the main character. There is not a lot of good things about it. But still, it is important to know all of a good portion of what happened in the previous episodes with the plot so that you understand the context of why what I just saw was so fucking fucky. And I really did just see it. I finished watching it maybe 20, 25 minutes ago. And while I think it's important to know all that stuff, I don't think sitting through it is a good use of time. hopefully I can do it a little quicker. Like I said, I usually like to have bullet points of some kind in front of me when I talk about something like this. Like, when I talked about Fantastic Four, I had, like, a list of bullets that I was able to go through. I don't really have that here, so hopefully I am good enough with the English language that I can paint enough of a picture for you with my words that's entertaining enough for you to want to sit through and listen to me just talk in front of a door for the next however long I intend to talk. So, with that said, for the uninitiated, or has become my catchphrase, for those of you who don't know, Lance N Masques is a story about a world where there is an order of knights, but it's set in, like, the modern day. But they have dwindled to the point where they're all basically set on just, like, one island where they all live. Where they live and they train, and they are the knights of the world, is what they're called. Our main character is Yotaro Hanabusa. He is, I don't know his age, because everybody in the show is animated to look very, very young. Like, even the characters who you know are on the older side, like, probably between their 30s and 40s, still are animated to look like older teenagers, young adults. Like, they're animated to look my age. You know, he's like, I shudder to think what anybody who is actually my age in the show, if anybody's 24 in the show, I shudder to think they probably will look 17. But the main character, I want to say I think there's an episode where they say he's in, like, middle school, or he's just about to enter high school. So he's in that, like, 13 to 15 range, but his character model makes him look like he's, like, 12. But regardless, he is a knight himself. You know, the first episode is he gets knighted, but he doesn't like the knight lifestyle, so he runs away, and he goes to the mainland, where, you know, he basically, what he has is, they call it a white knight syndrome, where, and this is very important, whenever he hears a female screaming, he immediately has to run towards the source of the scream. And he must save them from whatever was causing them to scream in the first place. So in the first episode, he comes across this girl who becomes a main character later. And she's getting, like, kind of harassed by these street punks. And, you know, they're just kind of like, you know, they're kind of like kids themselves. And they're just like, oh, hey, pretty lady, what you got up that skirt, girl? And it's like, oof. So he runs in, he puts on a mask and a cape, and he has this very, you know, basically he looks like Tuxedo Mask. And with purple hair. And he, you know, he runs in and he saves the girl, and the street punks leave. And so what he does after he saves her is he gets down on one knee and he grabs the heel of her hand and he kisses it, and he calls her my lady because it's basically, these knights are always chivalrous. That is a big tenet of their lifestyle. So he does that, and she doesn't react well to that. You know, even though these, you know, street punks were just, you know, basically like, you know, lift up your skirt! And she was just like, oh, get away from me, this guy is just saves her, and just a little kiss on the hand. I hope you're safe now, my lady. She calls him a pervert, because he's an anime protagonist in a pseudo harem show, so naturally, he's a pervert. So he leaves. You know, he's like, why would she, he doesn't understand this. He's like, why would she call me a pervert? I don't understand. So he goes out into this, like, really, like, open field area that has some cliffs and shit. And there's a little girl on these cliffs. Her name is Makio. And she... Fuck. She looks... She's animated to look 5, but she's probably, like, 7 or 8 years old, something like that. 5 would make it creepier for the stuff that I'm about to describe, but, anyway... She's climbing the rocks, you know, just, you know, like a little adventurer, fine. I don't have a problem with that. In fact, when I first saw the show, and I knew very little. I only knew, like, you know, watch this show blurbs about it, like, this is a show about a guy who's a knight who has a big fucking lance. Cool, I'll watch that, I'll watch an episode of that, see how it is. Where is it going? Oh, yes. When I first saw the little girl climbing the rocks, and I was like, okay, so she's a main character, I was actually kind of interested in that. I was like, oh, like a little girl character who's like climbing rocks, she's like a little adventurer. Maybe they could do a lot of interesting things with a character who has, you know, kind of extreme sports interests like that. There's all sorts of stuff you could do. So she's climbing the rocks, and she slips and falls. And as she's falling, she screams. And of course, Yotaro hears female screaming, so he immediately puts on the mask, he unravels his lance, and he bolts off and he saves her. He saves her from falling, and again, when he puts her on the ground, he says, "My lady, I'm glad you're safe." And he kisses the back of her hand, and he fucks off. So from that point on, she dubs him Night Lancer and calls him he's an amazing hero, his name is Night Lancer, because she's an uncreative little child. I think when I was a child, I probably would have named him something like, Big Fucking Stick Man. I guess I wasn't that creative as a child either. Anyway, Big Fucking Stick Man, he leaves. And he goes, he takes off his mask and he takes off his, like, cape. And he, like, basically does what I'm doing. He basically starts supporting the nearest wall. And he's like, you know, he's like, oh, what was I thinking? Why did I leave? This is a terrible idea to come to this island. And he's like, he's got no food, so he's, like, hungry and he's crying. He's like, oh, what was I thinking? And Makio, having just been saved, like, kind of follows in the same direction that Night Lancer took off in. And she's like, oh, where is Night Lancer? And she sees Yotaro. And he's like, and she offers him, like, he basically informs her that he's hungry, he has no food, he's got no money. She offers him a place to stay, so she takes him home with her, you know, like you do. Whenever you meet a random stranger crying on the street, you're just like, man, you just, come with me. So he does, and he finds out that she lives in this giant fucking mansion all by herself. She has a group of maids, but they go home every night, so she's got nobody. Like, her father doesn't live with her, they don't know any, like, the mother is MIA. So, it's perfect, so now he can just stay with her. And from that point on, the next couple of episodes, they have, like, kind of, like, shenanigan-y, fights with kind of chump people. You know, just to kind of show, like, to kind of build up Yotaro as a character who is powerful enough to defeat chumps, which he does. And in one of the early episodes, well, we're in episode 5, they're all early episodes. In one of the episodes, he finds out that Makio is going to be taken away. Her father, who is the owner of a very, very, you know, ludicrously powerful organization of some description, he decides arbitrarily that, you know what, Makio's not living in this big fucking house in Japan by herself anymore. We're gonna take her to somewhere else where she can live by herself in a giant fucking mansion. So, Yotaro, I don't forget his reasoning. I think it's something along the lines of, if she leaves, I don't have a house anymore. I forgot. Some other people from the Night Island have come over and were looking for him, and they have found him, and now they are living in the giant mansion as well, including his, like, angry mom maid character, who is just, like, I think she's just, like, his guardian or something, and she's just an angry person. Her name is, I think her name is Yoriko, and she carries a whip. She's just very mean-looking. She's one of those characters who's, like, 30 years old, but is animated to look like my age, so she's just a treat. There's a girl character who's, so far, her main character trait is girl. I forget her name, so I'm unfortunately going to have to just refer to her as Girl. His horse, who has the ability to turn into a girl, a different girl, but I remember her name because her character traits also include the word horse. So, her name is Shirohime. The three of them have come over to the island as well, and they're all living together like a big ol' hunky-dory fucking sitcom. Living in this giant mansion, because, and it's a good thing that no one else lives there, because now everybody's got their own room, isn't that fucking sweet? So, they don't want Makio to be taken away. I think that's why Yotaro doesn't want her to be taken away, because if she gets taken away, then he'll have to go back to the island and kind of have to explain to the higher-ups on the island why he ran away, and he'll have to, you know, he'll actually have to suffer consequences for his actions. What a reasonable thing for a hero to avoid. So he goes to the corporation to talk to her father directly, and he goes there and he meets a former friend of his who also used to live on the Night Island, but he is, I don't remember his name. He had some fucking Japanese name that I don't recall, but every other character just referred to him as the boss, so I think I'm gonna call him the boss. And he's like a bodyguard for for Makio's father. So I guess you could say that the boss has a boss. So I guess Makio's father is just the boss. So the boss has hired the boss to be his bodyguard, and he's basically he's the one who's ordered, he's like, I need you to collect Makio, and Yotaro's talking to the boss, the boss, not the boss, the boss. And he's like, hey, the boss, you know, why are you taking Makio away? This isn't good, that's not fair, like, why doesn't she get a say in this? And it's like, you know, you're kind of barking up the wrong fucking tree here, kid. So they fight a couple times. Like, the boss wins once and breaks Yotaro's lance, and Yotaro's like, oh, I am so weak, and he eventually gets over this, and he goes and he fights the boss again. Oh, that's why, because they kidnap... They kidnap Makio. It's like, there's gonna have to be a drinking game for the number of times that little girl gets kidnapped, because I think by episode 5, which is where they are now, I think she's been captured like 3 fucking times. So, 1, 2, 3. That is such a good idea. How much is in this? 5.9? That's not that bad. Anyway. Excuse me. So... One of the first times she gets captured, he goes there as Night Lancer, he fights the boss again, and he wins. Now, the boss was responsible for taking down a criminal organization called BAM. It's a terrible name for any organization, whether it's criminal or benign. So, he took down this evil organization, which had employed, like, kids, like child soldiers, which is a really interesting, really terrifying plot point that they never really go into. Could really take some pages from the new Gundam series, which is basically all about child soldiers. Nope. Doesn't want to do that. Too busy focusing on the goofy aspects, which I'll get into. So anyway, a couple of these kids do not like the fact that Yotaro was able to beat the boss. The two main ones, their names are Yuhua and Yuyan, and Yuhua is actually one of Makio's former maids. But she's just kind of like, she accepts it. Like, she's like, okay, he fought you, you lost. Because, like, even the boss is cool with it. Because, again, he and Yotaro are former friends, and he's just like, yeah, he beat me fair and square, so, you know what? It's water under the fucking bridge. The father decides to let Makio stay, but Yuyan is like, fuck, he's probably like 11 or 12 years old, something like that. He does not take it well, so he's like, I will avenge you, even though you are not dead. You are just sitting in a hospital bed with, you know, the fucking anime injuries, which is a band-aid on the forehead and maybe like a fucking wrap around the wrist. It's like the only thing you need to avenge is a fucking Ace Bandage sales kid. You know, I will avenge your flesh wounds, your very minor flesh wounds. So he goes and he kidnaps Makio. I already did it, so. He kidnaps Makio, and he injures Girl. So when this all happens, I was like, this is an interesting development. This is actually some interesting shit. Cool. No, because, like, when it all happens, I was like, Makio has been kidnapped, and girl is injured. I was like, wow, they killed off girl. That was fast. And that's, like, an interesting development. It's all solved immediately in the next episode. I feel like, actually, this was episode 2. This was probably the first time Makio was kidnapped. But, you know, whatever. I don't get paid to remember shit that well. Regardless, suffice it to say, Makio has been kidnapped by this fucking dumb kid. And he loses. Like, he is soundly defeated. And it's like, no, like, you know, everybody scolds him. Like, why the fuck are you doing this? Like, stop it. So his reaction to that is, oh, I failed. I should try again. And he does. And this is where we start getting into the fucking nonsense that I just watched. There is another character introduced, whose name is Yufeng. Two more characters, actually. There is a Yufeng and a Sylvia. Sylvia is another girl who lived on the Night Island, but has more character traits than girl, who is currently living with Yotaro. She is introduced as, like, a childhood friend. And this other character named Yufeng is introduced as a mysterious girl. So they appear for reasons that I don't remember, and I don't feel like looking up. The two of them appear. Sylvia is looking for Yufeng because she used to be part... I want to say she also was part of Ban. She was also part of Ban, and she had... she lived with, like, a father character whose name was Shifu, and he is dead. So she is looking for a replacement. Daddy.
I've given it away. That's what she's looking for, but when she first is introduced, she's like, I am looking for the strongest man in Japan.
And it makes you think that her intent is to kill them, and she runs into Yuyan, who's like, oh, she's looking for the strongest man in Japan, she's got a sword, and she looks really angry, she must be looking for the boss. Well, I'm going to redirect her, and he says, I know who the strongest man in Japan is. It's this Knight fucking Lancer guy. So she's like, I will find him. And this is where we get into what I just watched. Buckle the fuck up, people. This is where things get a little ludicrous. So this is we're at episode 4. At this point, at the end of episode 4, Yufeng finds, Yotaro, and he is dressed as Knight Lancer. Also, an important thing to note at this point is that the girl in the beginning, her name is Sei, she has become friends with Yotaro. Even though she thinks that his Knight Lancer persona is a pervert, she doesn't know this. This is a secret he is keeping from her as well. They have become friends because, as is necessary with all anime that don't need a school setting, the anime has decided to put in a school setting. So both Makio and Yotaro enter this school, which is just so lucky enough to have elementary, middle, and high all in the same building. I'm sure those exist. I never saw one. I've never been to one. I'm sure people have. I don't care. Don't point it out to me. I'm sure they exist, but for the purposes of this, they don't exist! So they go to that. It's just convenient. So they all go to school, and that's where he's met Sei, and she's like, wow, you're such a kind person. It's like, when you're not wearing your knight costume, you're not a pervert, you're just a nice guy. You're only a pervert if you say my lady. So at the end of episode 4, Yufeng finds Knight Lancer, and it looks like they're about to get ready, like, you're like, oh man, next episode, these two are about to fight. So she says, the strongest man in Japan, Knight Lancer. And then she goes, Papa. Papa. And, like, and then I saw that, and I immediately talked to my co-host on the Wasting Time podcast. I said, man, this show just got fucking all sorts of weird. He's like, is it a good weird? And I said, no. So I was like, but I'm interested to see how this rabbit hole goes. And I'm going to take a quick aside to kind of talk about that for a second. Now, like I said,
If you were paying attention earlier, I said that by this point in the season, you can tell what is going to be good and what is going to be bad. And it's like, well, are you still watching? Why are you still watching the shows that you can pick up as being bad? The reason for that is because I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's some sort of weird Schadenfreude thing, some sort of catharsis that I get from watching things that I just need to see how deep the rabbit holes on some of these shows go. So for something like Lance N Masques, you know, I am looking to see just how fucking weird this show is getting. That's why I'm still watching it. That's why I decided to start. That's why I decided to watch episode 5. But it's different from other shows. Like, sometimes I will also watch shows, like, last season, the big one for me was called Sky Wizard Academy. That was a show that, you know, didn't really have a lot of weird shit, but I kept watching every week because it was just terrible. Like, it was really, like, it was horrible on a technical, structural level. Like, it would bring up plot elements just to drop them and then bring them back 2 episodes later. And I got a whole fucking review planned for that shit. That was from last season. But that was one that I kept watching to see how worse it could get from a storytelling standpoint. Lance N Masques is one that I want to just see just how fucked it gets, because it is just a complete batch of what the fuck at this point, and I am very curious to see how goofy it gets. Now we can start talking about the episode proper. So it starts where the last one left off, and you've got this, Yufeng is like, Papa! And he's like, now ordinarily, the ordinary reaction that a normal 13-year-old boy might have to a 12-year-old calling him Papa would be, no. See, you don't understand. No. There's no explanation that is needed. It is just a simple no. Mm-mm. Nada. No thank you. Porque no. That is not how you say no thank you. No gracias. Why did I say porque? That's what and because. Ugh. I haven't taken Spanish in a while. Good lord. Anyway. So, instead, his reaction is, okay, if that is what you want, my lady, if you want me to be your father, then I am your father. This is a minute in. This was, I swear to you, 1 minute and 5 seconds into the new episode is when he says, I am your father, if that is what you want. Okay. Alright. Let's keep going. Maybe something comes from this. Maybe. So, he leaves, of course. So it's like, just like any good father, I am your father. Bye-bye. He runs away. And then he takes off his mask and he's like, what? He's like, wow, I'm a father now. Aww. You know, comedy. Oh, I'm almost done. So anyway, he goes back to the big mansion where everybody is. And he's like, oh man. It's like, I don't understand. It's like, wow, this is all crazy. And he goes to school. And he bumps into Say. And, you know, she's basically kind of reinforcing, you're such a nice person. Oh, I forgot. There is a thing that they have set up at the school called the Night Club, which is basically Yoriko's way to make sure that Yotaro still trains to be a knight under the guise of being a school club. I was like, that's kind of a little clever. I'll give them that. So, Sei wants him to quit it because her experience with the one knight that she has ever met is that they are perverts. So she wants him to quit the nightclub, but he's too nice of a guy that he doesn't want to disappoint anybody. So as they're having this conversation, Sylvia, who is other girl, she comes in and says, I need to talk to Yotaro in private. And so she pulls him aside and basically is talking about how she was looking for, the reason why she came to the mainland in the first place was that she was looking for Yufeng. And you know, basically, at the end of the last episode, Yotaro found Yufeng and let her get away by running away himself. And he's like, oh, I'm sorry, I had no idea. He's like, I feel bad. And she's like, oh, whatever, it's no big deal, I'm gonna go look for her. And so she gives him, like, a hug, because they're friends, and he leaves. And then we see, Sei, who was eavesdropping. So she sees the hug take place, and she gets jealous. Because anime. She gets jealous and storms off, and she's like, what is he thinking, hugging a girl like that? I wonder what their relationship is. You could ask. But anyway, Sei bumps into a little boy, and it's, of course, it's Yuyan, and he's like, hey. And she's like, yes, can I help you? And he pulls out two fucking guns and points them at her face. The rabbit hole goes pretty deep, folks. Strap in. So he kidnaps her. This 12-year-old boy kidnaps a 15-year-old girl. And he takes her away. Presumably to do horrible off-screen things to her. We cut to later in the day. Yotaro has gone home. He's back in the mansion, and, you know, he's all sore from having been at the nightclub and practicing all day, and he's all stiff and sore, and Makio comes into the room, and, he's basically, you know, he's, like, he's trying to, like, stand up and be presentable, but he's so weakened from his training that he just falls over, and she's like, don't try to be tough, it doesn't suit you, which actually brings up one of the few kind of interesting things about Lance N Masques is that Yotaro, since he is leading this double life, this very ludicrous, very easy to see through double life, he, in order to keep up this facade, Knight Lancer is this, you know, this hero who is, you know, who he saves everybody and, you know, he's strong, whereas Yotaro is just this timid, meek, just kid. And, you know, I was like, that's probably one of the few interesting things that the show has going. Although, what it's being used for is completely ridiculous. Anyway, he's like, Makio is talking to him, and he's like, his phone starts to ring, he's like, and he sees that it's from Sei. And he's like, oh, hold on, what's going on? Hello, Sei? And Yuyan's there, and he's like, hey, I've kidnapped your chick. Okay. So, Yotaro, he goes dressed as Knight Lancer, and we find out that Yuyan has Sei tied to a chair in some fucking random building. And he goes there, and he's like, let my lady go. Let her go. And he's like, he's got two guns. He's got one pointed at her and one pointed at him. And he, like, fires, like, right next to his face. And she's like, I'll fucking kill you, and I'll kill her because you hurt the boss. And he's just like, I don't care what happens to me, just let her go. You know, the protagonist thing to do. He's like, I'm not playing around with you. And he points both of his guns at Yotaro, and he's about to fire when and here's a new drinking game we're gonna play. I don't think I have enough booze left, but a new little drinking thing is, how many times does a deus ex machina happen in this fucking episode? Well, here's the first one. As Yuyan is about to fire his guns, the tips of the guns get sliced off by a sword. And they're like, who could this be? And it pans out to reveal that it's Yufeng has appeared and sliced the tips of his guns. And if you remember, he was the one who said Knight Lancer is the most powerful man in Japan. So he still thinks that Yufeng's whole reason for wanting to find him was to kill him. So he's like, what are you doing? Like, why are you saving this guy? And she looks at him and he goes, you tried to stab my papa. And he's like, huh? So now she wants to kill him. She Yufeng wants to kill Yuyan, who is now an unarmed 12-year-old child. She is going to stab him with a sword. She's going to run him through. And She's, like, leaning back for the slowest fucking slice in history. And as she's about to bring her sword down on him, Yotaro jumps in the way, and he tackles Yuyan out of the way of the sword. Saves him. That's two. So, once he is saved, Yuyan runs away, bawling his eyes out. He's petrified, so he's like, bah! And he's running away. Yufeng gives chase. And so Yotaro, he unties Sei, he's like, he does the same thing, just mwah, the kiss on the hand, and she blushes, of course, because, oh my god, lips. So she's like, like, she's kind of started to figure out, when she was talking with Yotaro, when she was talking with Yuyan before Yotaro arrives, they're talking about Night Lancer, and Yuyan kind of says, like, you really don't even know who that is, like, you don't know. Like, he knows, that's how he knows how to call, Yotaro in the first place. He's like, you didn't even know, like, you don't know who that is? Like, are you serious? It's like, and you, as the viewer, are just like, yeah, you fucking stupid idiot. Night Lancer has purple hair. There's only two people in this entire goddamn series with purple hair, and one of them is pointing a gun at you right now. So, which one do you think is Night Lancer? She's starting to put two and two together. So she doesn't immediately react and, like, slap him and say, ah, pervert. So she just says, you should go after her. So you should, because, you know, Yufeng is going to slice this little boy into a million fucking pieces if you don't stop her. So she goes, so he goes and runs after her. We see that Yuyan has bumped into Sylvia, who is, keep in mind, looking for Yufeng. So he bumps into her, and they're just like, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? And that's when Yufeng appears, and he's like, ah, I'm here. I am going to start slicing everybody. And Sylvia's like, oh, I've been looking for you. And so they start to, like, fight because Yufeng wants to get at Yotaro, or Yuyan. Oh, my, too many people fucking Y names in this goddamn show. So they're fighting, whatever. She manages to knock Sylvia out of the way, and she turns her attention to Yuyan, who trips and falls, and he's, like, backing up, like, oh, I don't want to die! And she goes, she should have learned her lesson the first time, that the overhead slow-motion strike is not the way to kill somebody if you want to do it efficiently. So, yeah, she goes for the overhead strike again, but it's pointed down this time. Instead of doing an overhead slash, it's, like, it's gonna be a downward thrust. So she goes like this, and, like, Sylvia jumps in the way, and she takes the sword right through the leg. That's another. Still got a little bit left, but a few more Deus Ex Machina's on the way. So Sylvia takes it in the leg, and she's like, oh, whatever. So she, and actually a really kind of cool little brutal scene, she, Yufeng puts her foot on, Sylvia's leg and uses it as, like, a stop to yank the sword out. And she's like, if you get in my way of killing this kid, I will kill you too. So now she's got it like this, and she's gonna just stab through both of them. And she rears back, and as she's about to stab him again, Yotaro appears, stands in the way. And I was watching this, I was like, is this bitch's sword gonna hit anything it's supposed to? That's another one. Oh my god. So, she has missed yet again. And she stabbed Yotaro. And she pulls the sword out, and he's like, oh god. All the pain! And she's like, I stabbed Papa! And she runs away. It doesn't stop there, folks. It keeps going. I was like, I had to pause because I was laughing so hard. I couldn't even believe this shit. So, she runs away. She runs away because, of course, she has to. And she, like, runs to the cliffs because anywhere in Japan, if you have to run away for an emotional moment, you're never too far from a cliff face that overlooks all of the city. You could be in downtown, you could be in Akihabara, and you could run down an alley and end up at a cliff face overlooking all of Japan. So she does this. She runs and she's like overlooking a cliff face and she's crying because she's like, I stabbed Papa. He hates me. And that's when Yoriko appears. If you'll remember, she is the maid, angry mom character. And she is pissy because Yufeng stabbed Yotaro, and she's probably done some other shit, too, that made Yoriko mad. But I think everybody makes Yoriko mad, so she's gonna kill her. Like you do. So she's preparing to kill her. She's got her own lance. She's like, I'm gonna freaking kill the shit out of you. And so they start to... Oh, I forgot. A stupid thing that happens. Yufeng had been under the impression that her original father, Shifu, was sick and died of being sick. And as she's about to stab Yuyan, he's like, I don't understand why you would want to kill me. This is terrible. Why are you doing this? This is why you and your father should have been killed. And she's like, wait, should have been killed? He died of being sick. And she's like, he's like, Yuyan's like, no, he was fucking killed, man, by our former organization. And it's like, yeah, you know, that's really something you should say to the person who wants to fucking, you know, stab you in the throat. but anyway. So Yufeng and Yoriko, two fucking Battle of the Wise, are about to fight, and they are fighting, and Yufeng loses because she's actually quite terrible. And Yoriko is about to put the finishing moves on Yufeng when who should appear but Yotaro. Drink up, ladies and gentlemen. Yotaro appears and, you know, is basically like, no, I don't want you to kill her because... How much time do I have left? Oh, okay. Sorry, checking the camera battery. Professional as fuck I am, huh? So she's like... He's like, I don't want you to kill this girl. And she's like, well, I want to. And so they have, like, a little mini fight that ends in nothing. Because they're the tips of their swords touch, and there's, like, a little burst of energy, and the fight is over, and it, like, it shows Yufeng, and she's like, Papa did this to save me! He loves me! And, like, that's when he explains, like, and Yotaro explains to Yoriko, is like, I am her father. And she's just like, she has the reaction that normal people would have, where it'd be like, huh? No. But he's like, yes! And she's like, fucking whatever, I don't care. So that's all over. He wakes up in bed, or the scene cuts to black, and then reappears with Yotaro in bed. He's been healed from his wounds. Sylvia now has to, it's telling me to charge it. It said 8 minutes. What a liar. I have to wrap this up. So he's woken up and he is completely healed. And they're like, where's Makio? And they go downstairs and they realize that Makio has brought Yufeng to live with him because she found Yufeng crying on the on like a park bench. And it's like, you're going to come live with me now because you're crying. And so everybody's like, you're gonna live here? That's really a bad idea because everybody here wants to kill you because you tried to kill two out of the six people that are living here. And Makio says, and remember, Makio's 7 or 8 years old. Yufeng is like 13. And she says, that's okay because I am her mama. Because I am Night Lancer's wife and Night Lancer is her father. That automatically makes me her mama. And Yoriko says... Sorry about that, folks. Camera battery died, had to switch it. I'd charge it for a little bit, but it's about to die again. Because I didn't want to charge it long, and it's really late at night, and I kind of want to go to bed. I seem to have also forgotten my place, so I'm just going to start from a random spot. And if it doesn't match up with what I just said, I apologize again. Blame this. I'm all out of booze, too. I drank another one in the time the battery is charging. Wasting time. It's a great way to be. Anyway, Yufeng has appeared, is at the house, and, you know, Makio said, this is my mama. And everybody's like, blah! And Yoriko's like, well, okay, but... you see, I'm not gonna, but Yoriko basically is like, I'm not gonna kill her, I just need to punish her when she's bad. And Makio's like, you're right, we shouldn't pamper her. And so Yoriko takes her little whip and whoosh, and everybody's like, ah, and it cuts to black. And that's the end of the episode. So, final thoughts. This episode of Lance N Masques was the funniest fucking nonsensical goddamn shit I've ever seen in my fucking life. I don't think I will ever see anything that tops it ever again. It was freaking incredible. I just can't even think of the words. This show is completely ludicrous, and I can't wait to see where it goes. I just want to see how fucking idiotic and stupid this show gets, and I got a really suspicious feeling that it will not let me down. So, that's all I've got. Figures, I had to wait another, you know, half an hour or whatever to get this all, to get the finishing touches of this recorded. I am a good planner. Since this is the end, if you have, watched Lance N Masques yourself, what did you think of it? Did you find it to be the, absurd amount of what-the-fuckery that I did? If you decide to go back and watch all of it and then watch this new episode, tell me your thoughts. Tell me what you thought. If you, subscribe to the channel and all that shit, follow me on Twitter at ChrisTheNerd92, check out my website and all that fun shit. I will see you guys on the next whatever I do. Night.